beginning of the year on Egypt, just ain't all that. And as we said in that teaching, that Egypt, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, and they got out into the wilderness, and Moses went up to the mountain for just 40 days. 40 days. Before the 40 days were up, they were making a golden calf, appointing a captain over them to take them back into Egypt. Now, they just got all the plagues, all the miracles of the plagues. They had the miracle of crossing over the Red Sea. I mean, how many of you have had the chance to drive across Yadkin River with it standing up on both sides of you and walking over on dry ground? And actually, it says that, you know, if you read it in the Hebrew, he actually congealed it. He froze it, separated and froze the water. So you're walking, so, you know, and listen, how many of you have ever seen Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments? How many of you have not ever seen it? Go get the thing and watch it. It's 1958. It is a, even for its era, even when you look at it today, you think, how in the world did they do that Red Sea thing? Man, that was really cool. And, you know, it's not all accurate, completely biblically accurate, 100%, but that's okay. I mean, a few things are off here and there as far as, because they did it from Hollywood. But the main storyline is awesome. And, of course, the crossing of the Red Sea, you had the plagues. Pharaoh lets them all go. They cross over on dry ground. See the whole Egyptian army drown in the depths of the sea. Get over here. Moses goes up into the mountain. And listen, 40 days, they're already making a calf. And listen, if you read it, go back to our teaching. Before the 40 days were up, they made the golden calf, and they said, "This be the God that brought us out." Wow. And they made a point of the captain to be able to take them back. And you know, and the Bible talks about how if they constantly kept looking back, there would be opportunity to go back. Okay? And so the whole point of this is there's nothing back in Egypt to go back to, that we are to follow and to go after God and pursue Him with our whole heart. He has a plan that's better than Egypt. God has blessings greater than anything in Egypt. God has a place for you and a habitation for you better than anything you're going to find in Egypt. Amen? Hallelujah. And so we began talking about, you know, the body of Christ, us having our part, doing our part, living in our part. And then we got over into Corinthians, got into chapter 12, got talking about different gifts and talking about, you know, the necessity of the different parts of the body. You know, everybody has their part. And, you know, if every part will be healthy and whole and do its part, we're going to be strong and flourish and grow. Now, if there's a part that's hurting, we need to nurture that part. Yet at the same time, you know, if we go starting cutting parts off, you know, taking an axe and cutting it off, that's not an idea. Our idea is always to restore to help. Amen? Hallelujah. But sometimes you gotta go in and do some cleaning up. You ever had to do that? I went to the doctor one time. I had an ingrown toenail. Anybody ever had an ingrown toenail? Had a big toenail, ingrown toenail. So a big toe, ingrown toenail. I mean, you couldn't even walk. You're walking like this. Anybody ever been there? You look down there, and every heartbeat goes, kaboom, boom, 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 boom. Oh, Jesus. So I go to the doctor, and I sit down on the table there, and he takes this needle about this. It looks like about this long. And he comes up to me, and he just goes, and he almost ended up on the other side of the room. Don't ever do that in front of a patient. Get off to the side. Because, I mean, I came off that table, and he was coming up with me. I'm telling you right now, because I had my hands, I was holding on, and my whole body just levitated right up and had my foot, and he was coming up with me. Woo! Amen. What he was doing, he was putting stuff in there so he could kill it, you know, deaden it, and then go in there and work and clean stuff out and, you know, clean it up and do cut the toenail back out and all that kind of stuff. Well, it had to be done. It wasn't joyous. And he almost didn't enjoy it. Hello. And I was stronger in those days. It's probably still not going across the room today. Bad as that hurt. So, we were talking about the body, and so we get down to verse 27 of 1 Corinthians. Now, you are the body of Christ, and members in particular. And God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles and gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues, are all apostles. What's the question, answer to that? Nope. Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Now, that means you have gifts of working in miracles. That means you can't lay hands on the sick and have them recover. The Bible tells the whole body of Christ we're going to lay hands on the sick. But not everybody has a ministry of working in miracles. Okay? Have all gifts of healings? Not everybody has a gift of healings. All right? Or a gift of healing. Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? This is not talking about praying in other tongues. This is talking about a ministry of tongues and interpretation of tongues. Okay? But covet earnestly the best gifts, yet I show unto you a more excellent way. Now, understand that the book of 1 Corinthians, how many know what the letters to the church at Corinth are? What kind of letters? Anybody know? Does anybody know? Corrective. They're very corrective letters. You know, Paul writes in the first chapter, he says, oh man, you know, you guys come behind and no gift. That got somewhat against you. And he spends a lot of this letter correcting the excesses of that church. Now he tells them, you come behind and no gift. Well, obviously they didn't come behind and no gift. They were all prophesying. They were all shouting out in tongues. They were all trying to do everything. And Paul had to come in and bring correction, not so they would stop, but so that it would be decently and in order. All right? And so then they even got to the communion table, and you had people in the church acting like a bunch of heathens while people weren't even getting any food, and they were doing it, quote, at the table of the Lord. And Paul rebuked them for that. Shall I praise you with this? I praise you not. Paul was very rhetorical in his writings. He used that a lot. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Now, that's King Jimmy, but it's probably in modern day languages. You think you can keep doing this so God's grace can come on you? You idiot. Paul didn't talk like that. Have you ever read Galatians where Paul wrote to the church and J.B. Phillips says this, you know, did you receive this? Oh, you dear, oh, you foolish Galatians, the King James says. Paul wrote in the book of in the J.B. Phillips translation, he translated it this way, oh, you dear idiots of Galatia. Hallelujah. You know, everybody has to walk in love. Yeah, he was walking in love. He's trying to straighten them out. You know, love is corrective. It is, but it encourages, it corrects, it rebukes, it gives instruction in righteousness. Amen. And so Corinthians is a corrective letter. And so he explains your part in the body. Then he comes back and says, hey, but you know what? Starts in chapter 13, he says this, look, you got all these parts of the body, and you got all got these places, you're all doing these things, but let me say something, if it's not motivated by love, it's wrong. I mean, if you can prophesy, and you got faith, and you're moving mountains, and you're casting out devils just by waving one finger, they're all flying across the room, and you don't have love as your motivation, it's all wrong. Okay? And so he comes back and starts out, he says, I show you more excellent way, chapter 13, verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not charity. Now, I'm going to change the word charity to love because it is agape in the Greek. And charity, now understand this, at the time that the King Jimmy was written, charity, especially for the Brits at that time and thing, to give to the needy, because you wanted to give to them, there was such a class and caste system there that, you know, that the lower classes were like below. You know, they were the peons, you know, and the upper class, the monarchies or the lords and all the, you know, the dukes and all this were just such a station in life that everything was below them. So to give to those who were in a lower station, just because you wanted to be nice to them or kind to them, was the highest expression of compassion that they knew of. And so that word charity at that point in time meant that. It didn't mean giving to the United Way. Okay? As we use the term. Now we just, you know, we have charities. We just, you know, and we got charities for dogs. Oh, these poor animals. Please join us and give us $18 a month. Have y'all seen it? Oh, yeah. They're suffering now. Why did you hurt me? Why did you spank me? Why won't you feed me? Oh, for $18 a month. Oh, anyway. y'all seen them, haven't you? Well, the word charity meant more there than it does now. So let's, you know, let's take it in this case. It's love. It's the God kind. It's agape love. So we're going to read it that way. You know, so understand it's agape, the unconditional love of God. He says, though I speak with tongues of men and angels and have not the unconditional love of God, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so that I can move mountains and have not love, I am nothing. Now, what Paul is doing here is he is not saying that faith, love, prophecies, the word of knowledge, all these things aren't important. He's saying unless they are undergird from the character and position of love, they are not, they are useless. Because their motivation and their use of them are wrong. They have to come from the position of love. In other words, we govern ourselves within the body of Christ by the law of love. All right? Though I bestow my... We need to understand what love is. We'll get to that. Let me tell you what love is not. Love is you can do anything you want to and it doesn't matter. That's not love. Okay? That is not love. Love speaks the truth. In love, but it still speaks the truth. Okay? Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not the love of God at profit. See, there's a lot of people who give and do stuff, but they're not motivated by love. Some people give hospital wings and give their money for hospital wings, you know, to be built to take care of children, but it's not so they can take care of children. It's so that their name can be on it. All they want is their name on it. It's about their pride. It's about their ego. See, then it profits you nothing because it wasn't about love. It was about you. Your legacy is exactly right. Hello. Love suffers long. Love is long-suffering. It puts up with a lot of junk. Hello. I don't have the Amplified with me here. Oh, we have the Amplified here. It's amazing. You can say, I don't have an Amplified, and all of a sudden the Amplified shows up. Okay, I'm going to read King Jimmy first. Is kind, envies not, and love vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeks not her own, is not easily provoked, thinks no evil, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things, love never fails. Okay, let's go Amplified. For those of you who don't know what that is, it's the women's version. Guys, you had a really good chance to go, amen, Pastor, and you had to...
Amen.
All right. Love endures long, is impatient and kind. Love is never envious, nor boils over with jealousy. It's not boastful or vainglorious. Does not display itself haughtily. It's not conceited, arrogant, and inflated with pride. It is not rude, that is unmannerly. Does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights or its own way, for it is not self-seeking. It is not touchy or fretful or resentful. It takes no account of an evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. It does not rejoice at injustice. The Weymouth translation says, does not rejoice at unrighteousness or injustice and unrighteousness, but rejoices when right and truth prevail. Love bears up on anything, and everything that comes is ever ready to believe the best of every person. It's ready to believe. Now, folks, if somebody walks up and pulls a shotgun out and blows your husband or wife's head off their shoulders, you can't believe they were just misguided. You may want to believe the best of every person, but you know that you can't believe they really didn't mean ill will towards you. So we get foolish. We take things out of context, and we get off with those. We need to be more accurate and understand. Now, so let's go back here. Love suffers long, is kind. Now, what's he talking about here? Harry Drummond said that love is the supreme good. It comes from and is the best part of God. Love is more than a characteristic of God. It is his character. Love is discussed in many parts of the world. It's a vital part of Jesus' ministry and thought. Yet it never reaches a fuller, stronger, deeper presentation than in this chapter. Inspired by the Holy Spirit, with Christ in full view, Paul wrote this stirring description of love. Let's see here. Now, to understand the contrast Paul put between love and tongues and prophecy, understanding, knowledge, and faith, it's necessary to take in consideration why chapter 13 is sandwiched between the chapters of 11 through 14. The larger context of those chapters is that of public worship. Chapter 11, Paul was concerned to draw limits for the proper role of women in the church worship and how Christians should conduct themselves at the Lord's table. And 12 and 14 had to do with the proper exercise of the gifts of the Spirit in the church. Paul was forced to deal with these issues specifically because Corinthian Christians were exalting their Christian liberty and knowledge to such a degree that it made a mockery of the order of Christian worship. Paul insisted in chapter 13 that the model of Christian worship is love, not knowledge or any special gift in which the Corinthians thought they excelled. I remember one time we were at, it was camp meeting. It was camp meeting. And it was my first camp meeting, 1980. Now, I saw things in camp meeting I'd never seen before in church. I was a Pentecostal holiness boy. I'd never seen women in Daisy Dukes in church. I hadn't seen it. Doing this. And they worship, and I'm behind them. I mean, you're standing there, you kind of look down, all of a sudden you see this, and you're like, Jesus! And you spend the rest of the service with a kink in your neck. Because you can't look down. Because they're like this. And so one of my roommates, I said, man, that just ain't right. They're free in Jesus. Oh, I got rebuked for being, because they were free. They were too free. Because if they loved me as a brother in the Lord, they wouldn't force me into temptation. Well, it's your problem, not theirs. Now, come on now. Paul said he wouldn't eat or drink things offered to idols if it was going to offend his brother. See, love takes into consideration what your actions do to others. Do they affect other people that are watching? My wife, I got frustrated yesterday with something. Oh, I've had this ladder. It's one of those clink, clink, clink ladders. Well, it's tore up. You got to take screwdrivers and push the things down. But now it's at the point that I got to push two of them down at the same time and still try to grab the little lever and then swing it around. I didn't cuss. I did almost lose my sanctification. But I was raising my voice at that piece of junk. And my wife was so kindly reminding me that the people are watching you in my backyard. The neighbors got bushes 20 foot high, but they're watching. Must be up on the top floor with binoculars. I know it, because you know, you slam it down, you throw your screwdrivers down, and you walk off. You just recover. Anybody ever done things like that? You know, and I'm sitting here trying to control, you know, you're trying to do all this, and it's aggravating, and you got it just right, and it starts to move, and something slips, and click, no, can't do it. Then I got it all together, got it up, got it to the roof, and I can't get off and get on the roof because the gutters are there, and it's too wobbly, and anyway. So then I had to take it and put it back together. Clink, 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 clink. But I was watching. People are watching. Listen, you know, like I said, you know, when our neighbor passed away, he had a heart attack in his house and stuff, people came to us, and they knew that he'd been treating us rotten, apparently, because, you know, we had to go to the board and say, look, he won't leave us alone about our playhouse in the backyard and this kind of stuff. And then finally the neighborhood association president went to him and said, leave the guy alone. Just leave him alone. You know, and so we if our kids walked on his grass, they got mad because it bruised the grass and stuff. Yeah. You know, ball would go in the backyard, I mean, you know, it would bruise the grass to go pick it up. So, and then we had a little kid, you know, Nathan was, oh my goodness, Nathan was 99, that's 14, he was like 6 or 7, you know, little boys can play with a ball. Hello? Yeah, bruise the grass. So anyway, but you know, Janie took her to the hospital behind the ambulance, Janie waited with her and brought her home. We organized food for their family. You know, and then people were just like, you know, as the way they treated you and stuff, you know, so we gained a reputation because people do watch.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we didn't go out in the front yard and dance in the front yard, that he's gone now.
Thank God.
Well, bruise the grass. Nathan, get over there back there. Let's catch, buddy. And then the wife made sure we didn't, because as soon as she got the insurance money, she planted shrubbery all between the yards. And the landscapers kept saying, why don't you plant it? No, I want it right there so they can't get in my yard. Even after all the kindness, you know, some people just going to be, it just don't matter what you do, they're just going to be that way. But my point was this, is people are watching you. Amen? And so, when we come into the church, listen, we have to be kind one to another, and our actions affect other people. Amen. Isn't that right? All right, I've got to find my place back here where I was. So love is kind. It suffers long. It puts up with junk. Sometimes you just don't want to put up with junk, and you got to put up with the junk. I put up my neighbor's junk. I did. And we just kept being kind to them and put up with it. And then when they put the bushes up and the balls would go over, we'd have to go in covertly and sneak and crawl under the bushes like you know, Army Rangers and stuff, and come in and get the balls. Pop up out of the bush with your camo on. I got it! All right, Nathan, here it is. Here's the plan right here, buddy. You go in over here. I'm going in over there. Yeah, that's right.
Bravo team. Make contact.
All right, love does not vaunt itself up. It's not puffed up. When we begin to be arrogant and inflated with pride, you know, there's a lot of, you know, I've had Christians, people come in here before, and I speak in tongues, and da 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 da. Watch me. There's arrogance about it. Let me say this. However God uses you, stay humble. The use of your gift in the body of Christ, maintain humility. Amen? The Bible says of Jesus, he came as one meek and lowly. He had power. Oh, man, he had power. But he walked in a meekness and a lowliness and a humility about the gift that he was. Used it to minister life. Used it to bless people. Wasn't arrogant about how great he was with his gift. Yeah, you know, I got this and I can grow you. Watch. You're going to go around. You're too short. You want to be taller? I can grow you. Really? You know? We get arrogant with stuff. I've seen people do it too often. They get arrogant with their gift. I had a roommate. Now, his family blew too much wind up his skirt about how great he was. You know, and did not teach him to be humble. He was going to be teaching at Rainbow Bible Training Center before our year was over. God has showed him. I'm going to be teaching at Rainbow. See, you can't get arrogant about your gift. Let your gift, the Bible says your gift to make a room for you before great kings and men. Let it do it. Don't you do it. Stay humble before the Lord. Stay, keep a right heart. See, the love of God in you will cause you to walk with humility so that your gift is available to be exercised and minister out of love, not out of arrogance of how great you are. You know, nobody has it like me. No, but there's, you know, I love that word. That's the word. It's a word of prophecy to me from Star Wars. When they're on the water and they're going through the water with Jar Jar Binks in the little water plane or whatever, and this big fish is chasing them down, and about the time it's about to bite them, this bigger fish comes and eats it. And Qui-Gon Jinn, whatever his name is, Qui-Gon Jinn goes, there's always a bigger fish. See, we can't get arrogant about our place. Because God always has some. Remember, the prophet said, I'm the only one. Nobody else. He said, I got 7,000 haven't bowed their knee. So the love of God keeps us from being vain or vainglorious or puffed up about how great we are. Remember that without it being used, you being used of God, there is nothing there to give anyway. And too often we see people run off and begin to think that they've got something and they begin to do it without God. I heard a preacher say this one time, and it always bothered me. I love them. But, you know, when they made this statement, they said, you know, if Jesus wasn't Lord, if God wasn't real, if the Holy Spirit wasn't in the earth, I would still live by faith because it works. And I thought, whoa. When you can't remove God out of anything. They were trying to say the principles of faith work. But the only reason the principles of faith work is because God is God. Amen? We can't get arrogant about how great our faith is. Our faith is great because we serve a great God. We serve a great God who has great faith that he imparts unto us. And our faith grows exceedingly because our relationship with God. Can I get at least a grunt? Amen. So it always bothered me because love recognizes our place. I am the pastor of the church, but it's my place and my calling. And without Jesus Christ, without the anointing of the Holy Ghost, I'm not even a good sock salesman. Sock salesman. Or sock salesman either. Sock or sock. Okay, I can't sell. I can't sell oysters, and I can't sell socks. Somebody tell me that was a good save. All right. Hallelujah. You know, no, we can't become puffed up about how great we are. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Yes, you are. You're the righteousness of God in Christ. Don't you get arrogant about how, you know, people start saying this. We got preachers who go around and tell congregations, I can do all things. I can do all things. You can do anything. You can do all things. Quoting half of Scripture. No, you can't. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm not going to get arrogant about how great I am. Amen? I'm going to boast in the greatness of the God that's in me. Because it's the greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world that empowers me to do all things through him. And love for your brother and sister does not promote you. That's where you become vain and arrogant and puffed up. What do you mean doesn't promote me? I want people to see not me, but the Jesus in me that empowers me to do what I do. I am not a speaker. Just flat out honest with you. I had a sociology class in college, and I had to get up and give a speech on the proper use of a baseball bat, and it ain't to hit people. I've been playing baseball since knee-high to a grasshopper. And so I took my baseball to school, baseball bat. And I was going to give a demonstration on the proper stance and the proper swing patterns and how to bunt and all this. My knees, I had to have a knee operation when I got done. They were talking about something I knew everything about that I'd had one in my hand ever since I could just about crawl. I'm not a natural speaker. So I can't boast in me. We have to boast in the greater one in us. We have to boast in the anointing. It's the greater one. And the righteousness of God, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Not in me. My standing before God is not because, you know, I have great faith in him. My standing before God is I have great faith in the one who made the way where there was no way. My trust is in Jesus, not in my position, but my position in Christ. And my trust is in that I'm in him and he is in God. He stands before the Father. Amen. If I'm going to walk in love to my brothers and sisters, I will not elevate me. But as Jesus said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. I'm going to draw them unto you. If people are attracted to you, make sure they're attracted to the Jesus in you and not your charisma. Not how cool you dress. Or not what kind of tie. I remember back a few years ago, there was a well-known minister sitting on a platform, and this man walked by the platform, and his wife stopped and punched him. That's it, Charlie. You need some socks like they got on. That'll get you anointed. The power sock of the month. Now, some of y'all, now I know Bill's old enough to remember this. back about 30 years ago, there was a big satellite network, and they had a monthly meeting, and they had every well-known Word of Faith preacher you could have on there. But the church that was doing it, the pastor would wear a different tie every month, and it became the power tie of the month. And every pastor would go out and buy that color tie like that the next month so they could have the power tie, because that was going to bring the anointing. It is retarded. Some of the stupid stuff we do had nothing to do with his tie. Are you here? Has nothing to do with your socks. It has to do with Jesus. And if you remember this, they took note of the disciples that they were ignorant and unlearned men, but they'd been with Jesus. I said, they'd been with Jesus. And let me tell you something, folks. I don't need the power tie. I need people who've been with Jesus. Amen? You don't need a power tie. You need to be with Jesus. That'll fix a whole bunch of stuff. Pretty much everything. All right. Can I get a holy grunt? Sound like a bunch of cows. Okay. Does not behave itself unseemly. Now, let me say something. See, he's talking about, you know, see, we kind of use this a lot of times, how we go out into the world, but really talking about how we're conducting ourselves in the church. We don't behave ourselves unseemly. Don't treat your brother or sister in the church bad. Love on them. Yeah, but you don't know what they did to me. Can I say this in kind of modern vernacular? So stinking what? Let's get on. Don't behave yourself with an unseemly or unseemly manifestation. Amen? Okay. Vainglorious, that's what folly. It's not conceited, arrogant, and flavor pride. It's not rude or unmannerly. Does not act unbecomingly. Let's have attitudes one toward another in the church. Yeah, but you know, I am the head usher. I get to walk with Pastor when he's under the anointing. Now listen, I remember years ago, well-known speaker who's spoken in our church numerous times, called the head of a large organization. They were having their camp meeting. And said, what is it with your ushers? They said, what's going on? I said, they're rude. They're arrogant. You walk in, you're treated like you're an enemy of the state, and they're the FBI or something. So they got that position, got cocky. I'm an usher. You know, I got the coat. You got to do like I say, buddy. Remember, I sat down one time and sat in the seat in those aisle. There's nobody in this section. There's a few people sitting. And I said, you can't sit there. You got to sit over in this section. Really? Yeah, move. You got to move. I'm like, son, you better be glad I've been saved X number of years. Because 5 years ago, I would have taken you out right there on the spot for treating you that way. But I got sanctified somewhere. My Pentecostal roots. I prayed until I got wholly sanctified. No. But you know, I mean, your thoughts go through your head. Son, you're half my size, and you're treating me this way. I mean, it wouldn't take me much just to take you and you'd be down before that and be hitting between the rows. The other ushers wouldn't even know it. They couldn't come to your rescue. Now, we're not to be rude. We're not to be arrogant. We're not to be inflated with pride. You know, you may be an usher in the church, but that means you can treat people like dogs. We're to be kind one to another. Unless you're giving me a T-bone steak with the steak on it. I'll take the bone as long as the steak's on it. Amen? It's not puffed up. It's not vaunting itself. Trying to kind of run between three different things here and keep them straight without getting. The phrase unseemly carries the idea of anything disgraceful, dishonorable, or indiscreet. Doesn't behave itself unseemly. Conduct yourself with the proper decorum in front of people. Amen. I remember something that Creflo said a few years ago on a sermon talking about girls. You know, they'll go out there and they'll dress like. Like what he said, I'm just going to repeat him. I'm going to quote Creflo. What you willing to show, you willing to share. And then you're all out there in the mall talking loud so everybody's looking at you. See, Christians, when we come to church, we should not behave ourselves unseemly. We should be behaving ourselves with proper decorum. We should behave ourselves in a way that honors the Lord. Well, I'm free to do what I want to. See, this is the very reason he put it. People were extolling or exalting their Christian liberty above walking in love. Bible, you know, Paul wrote to the church, says, don't use your liberty. What did he say? Come on now, you should know it. Only use not your liberty as an occasion to the flesh. Isn't that what he said? Boy, y'all, listen, I thought this was pretty good. We're not slapping you. Some of you hit me with a sledgehammer. No. But this is what he says here. So we sometimes get real sloppy with agape. And we just love people. We love. You know, there are parameters of love. He's given parameters of love. He's saying that if you're walking in love, you're not going to act unseemly. You're not going to display yourself disgracefully. You're not going to display yourself without proper manners. Amen. All right. Okay. I love this. Seeks not its own. The love of God will prefer. We're talking about in the church. When we're in church, we prefer people above ourselves. That's not always easy. Come on now. We prefer ourselves lower. How many remember Gale Sayers? Anybody ever see the movie Brian's Story? About Brian Piccolo for the Chicago Bears back in the late 60s, early 70s. Anybody ever? How many's never seen that? Well, Gale Sayers and Brian Piccolo, they were Brian Piccolo was white. Obviously, Piccolo, that's an Italian kind of name. And Gale Sayers was black. And they were on the Chicago Bears. And they roomed them together. That was not about, back then, when you roomed a white guy and a black guy together, that was a big deal. Well, over time they became like, you know, tight, close, loved each other like David and Jonathan. They were bonded. Because, you know, it's amazing when you find out that, you know, just because somebody's skin color is different, that they're still human. They have the same desires, wants, dreams for life. Amen. You know, you don't have a black dream and a white dream. You have human dreams. People desire the same things in life. They want good. They want their families to be good. They want their families to grow. They want their families to be blessed. They want good places to live. They want good things to eat. They want, you know, good vehicles to drive. Amen. Are you here? Well, Gail Sayers and Brian Piccolo were roomed together, and during the time, Brian Piccolo started slowing down, losing speed on the 40, started losing weight, and when they found out he had cancer. And now, of course, Gail Sayers had blown a knee out, and Piccolo had helped him through his rehab and got him back into shape, where he ended up being a major star running back in the NFL. You know, if you go to Chicago, obviously you mentioned Gail Sayers, they know who Gail Sayers is. All right? Well, Piccolo ended up dying from cancer. And Gail Sayers wrote a book after all this experience called I Am Third. And it says, Jesus is first, others are second, and I am third. And then you create the acronym, You Are Third, Joy. Jesus is first, others are second, you are third. But the book was called I Am Third. And he learned the secret of the love walk is you always put the Lord first. Others come for a second, and then you show up later. In that order. See, the love of God will create a pattern in your life. We are always looking to, does this please and honor the Lord? Is this going to inhibit, hurt someone else? Amen? And then I come in on it. In other words,